Hello, and welcome. You are about to enter the Large K Podcast.
What's up, everybody? My name is Kazu, and welcome to the Large K Podcast. For this episode, I interviewed Evan Geesman. He's a songwriter and producer, also part of Grn and Gld Collective. He recently released his single Wyrm, which I will be playing right after this interview, so stick around. His music has a unique mix of experimental electronic music with a songwriter mindset. Some of his influences include Arthur Russell, Nick Drake, and Aphex Twin. Really great stuff. I think we had an awesome convo, and I can't wait for you guys to check it out. Before we move on, don't forget to subscribe and like my channel, and always, thank you for the support. This is Large K Podcast with Evan Geesman.
Yeah, no worries.
Yeah, did you grow up in like Santa Ana, like all your?
Yeah, actually, I grew up down the street in Santiago Park, in a house that my dad actually lived in before he and my mom were together. It was like their version of where Grn and Gld guys like live. So it was like, I think it was like three or four dudes that like lived in the house, and then when he and my mom got married, they moved in there. So yeah, I was born there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Growing up around the area, were there like a lot of DIY shows going around?
Yeah, there were. I mean, I didn't go to a lot in high school, mainly because I was like constantly grounded, but yeah, there were. I mean, Coos Cafe, I don't know if you've ever heard of Coos Cafe.
Coos Cafe. Is it like open mic or something like that?
No, Coos Cafe is like a punk venue.
Oh, really? Okay.
That started in Orange County, but now it's in Long Beach.
Okay.
But, like, a ton of people played there. But it used to be, like, a house that was just... I'm pretty sure some people lived there, but it was, like, they mainly threw shows there.
Okay.
But that was in Santa Ana. But, yeah, there's a couple little places, like, that people did DIY shows around here.
Okay.
But I really didn't start going to, like, playing shows and stuff like that until it was, like... 21 or 22. Yeah.
Yeah, same here. Yeah. Did you like grow up in like a, I don't know, did your mom and dad play music or like was a creative kind of household?
Yeah, my dad played guitar. He played a lot until like right around when my brother and I were born, but he was like a jazz guitarist.
Oh, really?
And stuff, yeah. But my mom didn't really play music, but they're both, like, you know, fans of music, so...
Okay, but they still encourage you to, like, play or something? Or...
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, I asked my parents for a drum set for Christmas, and my dad gave me a guitar, so that's how I started playing guitar, yeah.
Okay, so guitar is your, like, first instrument?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Overall?
Okay. Well, actually, no. When I first started playing music... It was, our garage was my dad had converted our garage into like a studio, and that's where he used to like practice with his band. And he had he had a computer out there that was like probably mid to late 80s computer. So it was like the like 4-color screen, like MS-DOS, and it had a program on there that was like a sequencer, like a MIDI sequencer, and then he had like MIDI modules, so you would send MIDI out from the computer to like, you know, something that had the sounds in it, and then that would like, and then you program everything. It was like, you know, like really early version of like Fruity Loops or something like that, you know. So I learned how to use that, and then my dad bought me like a little MIDI keyboard, and so I used to like program songs on that before I played guitar.
Oh, really?
Yeah, okay.
So you were like kind of like dabbling into a little bit of production beforehand. And like,
well, actually, that might be a lie. I think it was around the same time. I think, yeah.
Okay.
I'm not sure which came first. Guitar might have come first, but I think I really like was like writing songs like on piano and stuff like first. Yeah.
Was your, you said your dad was like a jazz guitarist, but was like the band like in that same lane too, or?
He played it in a bunch of different bands. He played in like cover bands and like bars and stuff like that. But he like jazz was like what he liked.
Okay.
And he played in a couple different like, you know, I can't think of what kind of jazz. It was like more like along this. I don't know if you've ever heard like the band like Yellow Jackets or like Level 42.
Maybe. Level 42 sounds really familiar.
Yeah, it's like pre-smooth jazz, I guess, would be like the word for it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's mainly what he did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Were you?
Yeah.
Damn. Yeah. Were you in any like part of the band? Like, were you in any band at all? Like before, like doing your solo project?
No, when I first started making music, I mainly did it by myself. That was like, I got a guitar in 8th grade, and then in 9th grade, I asked my parents for like a 4-track recorder for Christmas, and then I got like a little digital 4-track, and then I basically just started like writing songs on my own, like in the garage. And then, the first person I really started playing music with was, my friend Joe, who was actually a friend of my older brother, so he was a lot older than me. He was probably about, when I was, you know, 14, 15, he was, like, 19, 20.
Mm-hmm.
And he came over to, like, hang out with my brother and saw that I played music, and he played music, too. So we started playing music together. Like, he played drums, and we just, like, hang out in my garage and just, like, make stupid little, like, weird tracks. So
yeah.
He was the first person. I was never really in a band though. It was just like I would play with him, and then we would like make like weird kind of like dissonant math rock, like garage rock stuff, and we played like one show, and we just make like weird stuff under different names. We were known as Karaoke Party, and then we had a group called Grammar School Morning, and then we had Saddies from the Suburbs was another group, and then we played like my high school Battle of the Bands.
Oh, sick.
And it was basically him on like djembe, which is like a, you know, like a bongo type drum.
Yeah.
Him singing, making lyrics up on the spot, and then me playing guitar. But yeah, that was not really in bands, just making music with him and other friends.
You were doing like kind of a lot of those like kind of songwriter stuff, right? Like where it's like on acoustic, like
I would write stuff on acoustic and then lay down a 4-track and like do stuff with drum machine and like play a little drums myself, like add Casio keyboard on top of stuff. Like
Okay. No, I definitely feel that it's like you have like that electronic element but still combine it with like the songwriter kind of stuff
to
put it together.
For sure.
I was thinking, like, because I was listening to that album, Coil, and, like, I noticed that, you know, where it's, like, it's a really cool combination of the both.
Like,
kind of experimental, but still, like, kind of has that accessible side where, you know.
Yeah. I mean, up until I was maybe when I recorded the, like, my first, I mean, because I've recorded, like, tons of music. Like, I, you know, I made, like, EPs in high school, mm-hmm. and, but, like, the first thing I, like, really put effort into was, like, in, like, 2013, and I'd always written music on guitar, like, singer-songwriter stuff, and I, like, play open mics and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then I would kind of, like, separately, like, make music on my computer,
mm-hmm.
and, like, write stuff that way.
Right.
And I never really, like, combine the two.
Yeah.
And then I, you know, I, when I recorded, like, that first EP, I took songs that I'd already written and then kind of tore them apart, mm-hmm. in Ableton, and then, like, re-put them together and,
yeah.
pieced them together. So that's how that kind of started. But now I'm kind of wandering back just into, like, writing stuff on computer.
Yeah.
Like, I don't really, like, write songs on guitar anymore.
Right,
like,
yeah.
It's more, I mean, I'll play stuff on guitar, but I won't, like, write it, you know, starting on guitar.
Yeah, I haven't been to, like, an Evan Geesman show yet,
mm-hmm.
but for your, like, live elements, like, do you add, like, some live instrumentation too? Like, do you play guitar along with, like, your sequenced stuff? Like,
For a while, I had a friend's band, Flying Hand, that was, like, backing me up.
Mm-hmm.
And that was cool, but it's just too hard to get, it's really hard to get people together to, like, just play your music.
Of course.
You know, when they're already in their own bands, and
mm-hmm.
they're in another band in addition to their own band.
Yeah.
So it just got too hard to, like, and plus I like playing live, but I also hate it, and I was like,
yeah.
And just, like, practicing just to play live and thinking about playing live and how I'm going to do it and how I'm going to make it interesting. It's just like, I'd much rather spend my time, like, making music than,
right, yeah.
you know. Because, like, electronic music's not as intuitive to play live, at least in an interesting way, I feel like,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Especially, I don't know, there's, like, a, you know, a lot of beat makers that use, like, the 404 and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, that's what I've been doing when I play live. I play, like, loops and backing tracks on that, and then I play, like, synth over it, and then I, like, sing.
Yeah.
I haven't really incorporated guitar into it, but I'm trying to, like, switch up how I'm doing it to make it a little bit more interesting for myself.
Yeah.
Because people tell me, they're like, oh, I like your set, I like the way you play live, but it doesn't feel, like, anytime I'm not singing, it feels like I'm, like, faking it, or you know, something like that. Like,
execution is definitely the hardest part, right?
yeah
for like the name, like, I know you go by the artist name just like as Evan Geesman,
mm-hmm.
but like did you just like decided that you wanted to like kind of go with your like own name, or you didn't think about like going with like a moniker or anything like that? Or
I don't know, just like picking something that you're gonna be like forever, you know. Or
yeah.
not forever, but like,
yeah.
I don't know, I just didn't want to decide on a name, so I just went with you know, what I'd already been given.
Yeah. It's definitely recognizable. I mean, just knowing that it's you, it's like,
yeah.
oh, it's Evan.
Also, like, hard to spell and confusing when I'm at shows and I'm like,
yeah.
look me up on Spotify, my name's Evan Geesman. You don't know how to spell that. Yeah.
You're the only one on there, man, you know?
Like, yeah, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. When did you join the Grn and Gld Collective?
So, I have probably, like, 2013, around there, after I released that EP,
mm-hmm.
I met Benny, who's, that's Dirty Merlin. I actually lived down the street from them. They were in a, like, a warehouse space at the time called the Wizard's Den. It was him and, Rodrigo. And, I went down to some bar called the Avalon Bar. Excuse me.
Yeah.
And he was DJing there, and like everything he was playing, I was like, this guy has like my music library on his computer, you
right,
know? Like,
yeah,
so
yeah.
I went up and I was like, hey man, you got really good taste in music.
Mm-hmm.
And I started talking to him, and turned out he made music, and he's like, yeah, I live down the street.
Mm-hmm.
So I went over and hung out with him and like sang on a couple of his tracks, and then I played a couple shows at the Wizard's Den just like on acoustic,
right.
And then when I started to like, you know, work on that EP and I put it out, they asked me if I wanted to be a part of Grn and Gld, and I said for sure. So
nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was crazy because when I met them, you know, I put that EP out on Bandcamp, and then it started to get some attention, and like the dude from Bandcamp put it on Front Page, and mm-hmm. You know, it got a lot of plays and stuff, and a company like they're a record label called Manimal, they, like, hit me up, and they approached me about like doing press for me, but it was like a like pay for press type deal, and
right, yeah.
I remember talking to Rod and Benny about it, and telling him like, oh yeah, this company hit me up, but they want me to pay for press. And I remember them both like offering to like put up money like for me to, you know, to do that. And I was like taken aback, because I, you know, I hadn't known these guys very long, and I was just like, wow, like that's cool that they're like, I didn't end up doing it because I didn't necessarily like agree with the idea of like paying that amount of money for you know, that type of thing. But it was just really cool to know that they were like really down to like support, you know, other people's music. And so that was like a something that initially like, you know, made me want to like be a part of that.
Right. Yeah. It's like, it's a really cool trust, right? Like,
yeah. Yeah.
Create between like artists and stuff. Yeah. Cause like, since you're like mentioning like Benny, I wanted to like move on to like the new EP that you released.
Mm-hmm.
The me waving / Wyrm.
Well, it's more of a, yeah, it's more of a single, but yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, dude, I really like the second track a lot. And can you tell me a little bit about like those two songs
that
you
played? So that's basically I started recording the album that I'm working on right now about 2 years ago.
Yeah.
In like January, I rented a house out in Joshua Tree for like around 3 weeks, and was like writing and recording there. And as I kept making music after that, a lot of this, like, I started moving in a new direction. So I had all these tracks that I liked and I put a lot of time into, but they didn't necessarily fit with like what I want to do for the release I'm working on.
Right.
And before so much time passed that I like started to hate them as not hate them, but you know, just like, you know, you listen to older stuff you make and you're like, that's not really, you know.
I get you.
So I had that and I decided might as well put it out. And I hadn't put anything out under Green and Gold, so I put that out. And then I had that track, Me Waving, was like, I have like, you know, ambient kind of stuff that I worked on, and I thought they kind of complemented each other well. So
yeah.
I put them out. And then as for further incentive to get me to release them, I decided like I would, you know, anybody that paid for it, I'd donate the money to like United Alliance for to End Homelessness.
Yeah.
Just to give me some sort of incentive to, you know, at least I'm like doing something with it. And because initially when I told Benny I was gonna release it, I was like, Yeah, I'm down to release it. And then I like smoked a bowl later that night and then like re-listened to it, and I was like, oh, this is horrible, like I can't release this. And then I kind of like came to the next morning and decided to do it anyways. But
you said you were recording it in Joshua Tree, but do you feel like I don't know, going to like a different place, it kind of expands your creativity in a sense? Like,
oh,
like,
for sure. Yeah. And there's just like no, there's less distraction. And When you spend money to go somewhere to do something specifically, it's,
yeah, that's true. It
gives you a reason, you know.
Yeah.
And I would just wake up. It was nice. I'd wake up every morning. I'd like cook myself breakfast, like make some coffee, and then I would work on music till about like 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, and then like I could just walk out my front door, like into the park, and like go like hike around and climb on some boulders, and then come back and like work on music until I went to sleep. So yeah.
Yeah, I was actually at Joshua Tree not too long ago.
Yeah.
Beautiful place, huh?
Yeah, it's probably, like, one of my favorite places. Some of my friends get annoyed because every time I want to go camp, it's always in Joshua Tree. Like, yeah.
Stargazing is amazing there.
You know, yeah, like, I just like it because it doesn't... It's, like, so quiet and open and unfamiliar. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you go camping, like, out in the forest, and it's like, yeah, like... trees. You know, I mean, not that it's like not beautiful and, you know, But I feel like you're like in a different planet when you're in like Joshua Tree. It's like you're on Mars or something.
Yeah, that's true. And plus, it's like not too far away either.
Yeah, so for like, sure.
You know,
yeah.
It's like the convenience behind it is like pretty awesome, you know? Yeah. On this podcast, I ask this question every time. But what's one of the most memorable shows you've ever been to? And for this, you can include both DIY or like a venue show.
That I've seen?
Yeah, that you've seen.
I'd have to say I went and saw this last year and a half. I've really gotten into house music, and which is funny because it was always something that I heard, and I like knew that there was good house music out there, but I feel like so much of what everyone's exposed to is like the lowest common denominator.
Yeah.
You know, so I went to like a rave, this weird like rave thing that Green and Gold got invited to play out in Pasadena called Cosmic Carnival.
Yeah.
And we went there and played, and like I just remember thinking, like, there's gotta be like good house music out there after like listening to a bunch of stuff there. And like on my Spotify, this guy Glenn Astro came up, and he's not like straight up house, but his stuff's like pretty housey. And I remember hearing it and be like, "Oh, this is cool." And then like just through that and related artists, I started getting all this other stuff. But like right after I like started listening to his album on Spotify, it came up that he was playing in LA, like a downtown like warehouse show. And I'd never been to anything. I mean, I've been to warehouse shows before, but I'd never been to like one that's like, you know, it's like a real like starts at 12 o'clock and like ends at 7 a.m. and it's so me and Chipmunk and Lobo and Dirty Merlin and my homie Tristan, we all met up, and it was like one of these shows where you like they give you an address, you drive to it, and there's a guy in like a U-Haul truck that gives you a piece of paper that has another address, and then you go there. It's, like, all, like, secretive. And,
yeah, it looks like it.
And, you know, we all ate some acid before we went. And then we, like, got there. We're, like, waiting in the line. We get in, and it's, like, this small, like, little place. And it's, like, packed with people. And I had gone there right after I'd gotten off work. So, I worked from, like, 6 to, like, 11:30 and got off and then drove there.
Yeah.
And then we got there at, like, 12:30.
Yeah.
And, like, I get in there, and I'm, like, really tired, and I'm, like, thinking, like, oh, what am I doing, man? I'd rather, like, go home, and, like, there's, like, so many people here, and, like, and so we're, like, sitting outside, and, like, I was, like, feeling kind of, like, overwhelmed, and, like, the acid was, like, starting to kick in, and I was, like, I was, like, oh, man, I think I might just take an Uber back to Chips, and, like, and then, like, I was, like, sitting out there, and then I started to, like, hear this, like, track inside, and I was, like, oh, this sounds good. I'm, like, maybe I'll just, like, go inside and, like, you know, try to dance. I'm not really, like, a dancer either, like, but I'm, like,
me neither.
You know, this is, like, what I'm, you know, this is what you do. So I go inside and, like, next thing you know, it's, like, 7 a.m. and they're, like, turning the lights on. And, like, we had been dancing inside for, like, 6 hours.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, like, I mean, we'd step out every hour for 15 minutes, like, smoke a cigarette and, like, you know, cool down because it was just, like,
yeah,
the air is just, like, thick in there. But I've never been to a show where I had more fun, where, like, people were, like, super nice. So I just remember throughout the night, like, complete strangers standing next to me, like, they'd turn and look at you, hey, man, you having a good time? Like, this is fucking awesome, right? And, and the dudes that played, it was Glenn Astro and another guy named Max Grafe, just, like, playing, like, the greatest music. Like,
wow.
Yeah, it was, like, I would probably say that's the, in terms of just like the amount of fun I had, like, and it just being like a new experience, like, that was probably like one of the best shows I've been to for sure.
Damn.
Yeah.
It's one hell of a party then.
Huh? Yeah.
Especially with like acid and all that too. Mm-hmm. Like, did it enhance your experience even more, or like?
Oh yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. Like, yeah, and it was just like. And it was just, like, so loud. It was such a tiny space. I feel like it was maybe a little bit bigger than this room.
Right.
And, yeah, sorry for the train, by the way.
Yeah, it's all good.
yeah, these had, like, huge speakers, and they had, like, a bar set up in there. And I remember waiting for a beer and just like watching a beer can like move across the bar top because the speakers are so loud,
right?
Like,
yeah,
and I'm just like and like so tripping like, out at the same time, being like, this is just, like crazy, yeah.
Wow, dude. Yeah, I wanted to ask, like, you know, since, I mean, this kind of like, this like in the spirit of Halloween, you know,
yeah.
I was wondering, what's your biggest fear as an artist? Or it could be something personal if you don't really have one as an artist.
My biggest fear as an artist? Would just be not finishing things. I don't really have, like, I feel like I should, you know, like, I feel like the stereotypical fear an artist has is, like, they're not gonna, like, make it, or,
right,
you
yeah,
know, that they're
yeah.
not gonna be able to support themselves off their music, but, like, my constant point of anxiety is just, like, I always feel like I'm taking too long to, like, finish things, you know, so,
yeah.
I think 2 years is the longest I've ever worked on, like, putting something out. But I mean, I've put out, you know, like I put out those two tracks, and then like last year I put out like an EP of like dancey music that
mm-hmm.
I had been working on.
Yeah.
But in terms of like the album that I'm working on, just like getting things perfect and weaving in and out of like loving things and then like not liking them anymore and then hoping I finish them before I stop liking them and
right,
just like
yeah.
stuff like that. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. There are definitely like those moments where it's like you work on like the track for so long, but because of like on those perfectionist mind, like, you know, sometimes you don't even want to put them out, you know?
Yeah.
I definitely get that sometimes. Good, but it's like it's important to just release them and like, you know, so you can move on to something else. Yeah.
Yeah, I think the trouble I have is generally with vocals. I finish stuff pretty quickly, like the bones of things,
mm-hmm.
but when it comes down to recording vocals, it's something that I put off. Like, I put it off till the end. I don't do a track and then finish the vocals and then that song's done. It's like right now I have like 17 tracks that are just like I have lyrics written, I have all the vocal melodies, but like,
yeah,
something about like that's like the final piece, and it's also like very personal. It's like my voice.
Yeah.
You know, as opposed to like laying a synth part down or playing some drums, it's like that I can.
Yeah.
That there doesn't seem to be like a lot of pressure or like weight behind it in my mind, but when I record vocals, it like it kind of like scares me, you know?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
A lot of times I'll record like scratch tracks and like I'm not worrying about things, so
mm-hmm.
I'm relaxed and I'll just be like bullshitting lyrics and
mm-hmm.
and then that track's like the one I get attached to because it has the most like feeling and emotion and it's like
yeah.
the most raw, and then you like write the lyrics and then try to go back and like capture that, and it's always like really hard to like, you know,
yeah.
get in that mindset again and not be thinking like, oh, this is the final, like, you know,
yeah,
the final take of a song or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That goes the same with me too, where it's like I'll write like a guitar track, but then like the vocal and like lyrics are like completely last, so like you just as a feel you start singing the melody and
hum
over it, you know, but
yeah.
then when you try to add the lyrics together, it's like, okay, this doesn't really sound right, and you sit on it for like months and like,
yeah
I totally get that, dude. What is it called, are you currently working on new full length right now?
I have been for a while.
Yeah, is it gonna be like different from like what you've been working on in the past?
I think so. It's definitely there's a lot of it's got a lot of like housey influence in a lot of the songs,
mm-hmm.
And I've been listening to like a lot of like R&B and like neo soul and stuff like that, and so it's definitely got like that vibe to it, and
kind of like Erykah Badu type stuff, or like.
Well, I've been listening to like a ton of Frank Ocean, a lot of D'Angelo, a lot of Anderson .Paak.
Okay, yeah.
And then like a lot of like house guys like Fritz Wentink and then like Glenn Astro and stuff like that. So it's got that kind of vibe to it. And I've also just been like, it's a lot more like synth heavy. a lot more like analog synth on stuff. And yeah.
Definitely. Are you a fan of Blonde?
Blonde?
By Frank Ocean.
Oh, Blonded? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's, I've been listening to that like nonstop since it came out, pretty much.
Yeah. I don't know what it is, but like, cause I know like Channel Orange definitely has like a more of like a traditional, you know, soul-ish vibe to it.
Yeah.
Like, I just love all the new Frank Ocean stuff so much that like,
yeah,
it's just so
yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I like Channel Orange, but there's like a couple songs in there that I like kind of like fuck up the flow of the album for me, I guess.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
But Blonde is just so diverse and like,
yeah. No, that album's great, man. It's like super good. The production on it's great.
Yeah.
I was actually just watching a video yesterday of an interview with his engineer.
Oh, I saw that.
But it was for his engineer that worked on Channel Orange.
Yeah.
I don't think he worked on Blonded, but it was like interesting to hear, like, you know, how they put stuff together.
I think it was interesting, like the part about like how he like does like the whole playback of like the recordings, where it's like he has like a laptop, like where he hears stuff from like a laptop.
Yeah, that's funny. I was just yesterday morning, I was just looking up those cheap computer speakers.
Yeah.
That he recommended, because when I mix stuff, I always take it out into a car, and then I'll listen to it like on my iPhone speakers, and then, you know.
Yeah.
But it'd be nice to have something just for like reference, you know.
That's true.
Yeah.
Because like, it's not like everybody's gonna hear it through studio monitors, you know. So like,
We gotta
hear it through cars. That's where like most people put on their Spotify on and stuff. I always thought that was interesting. Cool. I think I pretty much asked everything that I wanted to ask, but I wanted to move on to this quick segment called This, That, That, where I'll be throwing you some questions, and like, you just answer it however way you want to.
Yeah, sure.
This might be an easy one for you. Cats or dogs?
I can't answer. I mean, I have a cat. I guess I'll choose cat, but they both have their pros and cons, you know. Cats kind of do their own thing. You know, they're loving when they want to be, and then like when they want nothing to do with you, they want nothing to do with you. And like, dogs are just like always psyched on you, so that's cool.
Yeah.
But sometimes you don't want somebody to constantly like need your attention.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's pros and cons to both.
Definitely.
But I guess I'll choose cats, just so my cat doesn't get mad.
Yeah. If you could go anywhere in the world, where would you like to go?
If I could go anywhere in the world, where would I like to go? The Mariana Trench.
What is that? Is that...
So it's the deepest part in the ocean. I mean, I could buy a plane ticket and, like, lodge... I mean... I could buy a plane ticket anywhere, I guess, if I really wanted to go, but...
Yeah.
Nobody can say they've been to the deepest part of the ocean, right?
Deepest part of the ocean. You'd probably get crushed or something. Like, you know,
nah, man, I'd have James Cameron bring me up a sub or something, right?
Yeah. James Cameron. And then next one, Nick Drake or Arthur Russell?
Oh, shit, that's hard. I'll have to say Arthur Russell.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that what you... I was wondering, did you grow up on Arthur Russell's music?
No, I grew up on Nick Drake's music. That's why it's kind of a hard question. But Nick Drake's... Nick Drake, you know, only has, like, two albums that I, like, really, really like. And Arthur Russell's just... Arthur Russell's, like, a great songwriter. Plus, like, he's just, like, all over the place. He makes country music. He makes fucking...
It's pretty out there.
Weird ambient cello music with singing and, like, disco and all that.
Yeah.
Did you do some research? Did you know I'd know who both of those people were, or what?
I guess.
Yeah.
Next one. Aphex Twin or Boards of Canada?
Aphex, for sure. I'm a huge Aphex fanboy.
Yeah.
That's, like, probably... He's, like, my, like, one, like, I gotta see him before I die.
Yeah. He plays a pretty experimental set from, like... from what I saw.
Yeah.
It's not like...
I wanted to see him at a... what was it, Day for Night Fest in Texas? It was like last year.
Yeah, it's in Houston. Yeah.
Yeah. I really wanted to go to that, but that was like plane ticket plus hotel plus $400 ticket. So
yeah, let's just hope that he tours here. You know.
Yeah.
How do you feel about 311?
How do I feel about 311? They're dope. I listened to them when I was in. I remember listening to them on my mom's compact disc skip protected player when I was a kid in the car.
Skip protected, so you couldn't like skip songs or anything. Like
no, that? you don't remember. How old are you?
I'm 27.
You don't remember compact disc players had skip protection? It meant like how hard you could like shape, you know.
Yeah, I remember.
It was like the more seconds it had, like the better, you know, better
yeah.
it was.
Yeah, I remember. Cool. Now this is the last one, but it's just like fill in a blank. Evan Geesman is
fucking white. I don't know, man. You gotta tell me like what context you want. Like
you could put it in any context.
Okay.
Yeah. If you wanna go to Evan Geesman is fucking white, then
yeah. I'm imagining how my friends would answer it. That would probably be it.
That'll be it. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Well, I just want to say thanks for like you know taking your time. And, like,
yeah. No worries, man. Thanks for driving out.
Dude. Definitely.
Cause it always does.
That was Evan Geesman. If you want to hear more of Evan's music, then check out the Bandcamp link in the description box below. More podcast episodes are coming, so don't forget to subscribe and like my channel. My name is Kazu, and I'll see you again on one and only Large K Podcast.